Welcome to the Coupler.io Academy, where industry experts share tips and tricks on working with data. In this video, we will talk about the types of Looker Studio charts. Hi, I'm Josh. Looker Studio, also known as Google Data Studio, offers many different charts you can add to your reports. There are, of course, regular tables and pivot tables, more visual pie or geo charts, and advanced visualizations such as Sankey diagrams or waterfall charts. Ready to explore them all? Join me for this tutorial on Looker Studio charts. In this video, I'll work with the dataset of PPC campaigns fetched from 7 different platforms. The data was imported and blended with Coupler.io, a platform that turns complex data into simple reports and offers hundreds of integrations with apps of any type. Looker Studio is one of its destinations. Others include Google Sheets, Excel, BigQuery, Power BI, and more. So let's jump straight into Looker Studio and create a new blank report. A table pops up right away, and it's not particularly helpful, so I'll delete it. To add a new chart, use the menu on top. Here, you'll see all the available charts grouped into categories. The first on the list are tables. There's a regular table, a table with bars, and one with a heat map. Let's build a table. I'll drop it here and zoom in. Many charts have a date range dimension. Once you set up a date range filter for your report, the field specified here will be used to determine which data should be displayed on this particular chart. Next is the dimension, the type of data that's described. By default, I have the names of my campaigns, which will work perfectly here. As a metric, I'll choose the sum of impressions for each campaign, as well as clicks. And here's the result, sorted by the first metric in descending order. Jumping back to my table, I may want to change the aggregation method for the clicks metric. Rather than sum, I'll opt for an average. It's also worth giving this column a more meaningful name than just clicks. Once you have a Looker Studio chart set up, you can change its type by opening the chart menu. Here's the version of a chart with horizontal bars. And here's one with a heat map. Change to any other available chart if you'd like. By the way, if you're new to Looker Studio and not very confident yet with all the chart configurations, then feel free to check out our extensive Looker Studio tutorial. You'll find a link in the corner of your screen. The next method of data visualization on my list are scorecards, a common guest to any dashboard. There's a regular scorecard and one with compact numbers. They're excellent for displaying KPIs, stages of a funnel, and more. Scorecards rely on a single metric. Record count isn't particularly useful, so I'll change it to return on investment and set it right away to average. In the settings, you can adjust the format. Here, I think 2 decimals would make a lot of sense. Next are time series charts. There's a basic chart, a spark line, and a smoothed time series chart. Let's drop a basic chart here and fix it right away because it's quite messed up now. A dimension on this chart must be a date field. If you have one in your dataset but it doesn't appear on the list, check if it has a calendar icon like my date start field. If it doesn't, you'll need to jump to the data source settings and adjust the type. As a metric, I'll choose conversions. The chart looks as it does because, by default, data on time series charts is displayed for each day separately. That's about 365 data points on a single chart. To change it, click on the calendar icon next to your date range dimension and adjust its type, choosing from many available options. Now that looks much better. And here's a sparkline version of this chart, and a smoothed time series chart if you prefer. Continuing, there are a bunch of interactive bar charts down the list. A column chart, a stacked column chart, and its 100% variant. To the right, there are identical charts, just in a horizontal orientation. I'll add a column chart. It takes in a single dimension. I'll choose a platform that a campaign runs on. And as a metric, I'll choose impressions. You can also add a breakdown dimension or just use a stacked column chart. I'll choose to break down by a segment that we target with our ads. And here's the ready chart. Next on my list of Data Studio charts is a pie chart in two versions that differ only by shape, a regular pie chart and a donut chart. A pie chart accepts a single dimension. I'll focus on a target country for our ads. As a metric, let's take a look at conversions. Simple as that. And here's a donut version of this chart. Now, I want to talk about a geo chart and Google Maps. It's a set of seven different charts that represent geographic data, such as countries, cities, and so on. There are six interactive charts built on top of Google Maps: a bubble chart, a filled map, a heat map, line map, connection map, as well as a combo map. Below, you'll find a standard geo chart. A geo chart automatically collects a geo dimension from your dataset, as long as you have one. If you expected to see a field here, but it's nowhere to be found, verify your data source. On the right, you should see a globe icon next to each geo field, like I have here. If an icon is different, jump to the data source settings and adjust the type. By default, the chart shows a count of records for each country. I will change the metric to CPA, cost per action, and I'll aggregate it by an average function. Now I can clearly see that Bolivia has the highest CPA among all the countries I targeted, and Australia looks like a good place to target with some more ads due to its reasonable CPA values. And here's a bubble version of this chart, a field map, or a heat map. Next on the list is a collection of line charts. We've got here a line chart and its smoothed version, a combo chart, and a stacked combo chart, as well as a box plot and candlestick charts. I'll go with the line chart. The campaigns work fine for me for a dimension. As a metric, I'll choose clicks as well as impressions. When metrics are of a completely different scale, as is the case here, one of the lines will linger around zero, which makes analysis tough. You can adjust it in the Style tab of the chart. Push one of the series to the right axis, which will fix the chart right away. And if you prefer a mix of line and column charts, the interactive combo chart may come in handy. The following graph I want to look at is an area chart. Here, you can choose from a stacked area chart, a 100% version of that chart, and an area chart. Let's grab this one and drop it onto my canvas. Oh, this one is tough to understand, but I'll adjust the date dimension in a few seconds. For now, let's set a breakdown dimension to be platform. And as a metric, I'll choose clicks. Now I'll choose to display data for each month, and it already looks much better. On an area chart, each color represents a different value in the breakdown dimension. You can see, for example, when Facebook ads attracted more than 20,000 impressions, and how suddenly LinkedIn emerged to take the throne in September. And if you're more interested in how each channel contributes to the overall result, then the stacked bar may be a better fit. Next is a scatter chart and a bubble chart. They are excellent for observing relationships between two different metrics, spotting trends, and finding exceptional results from a set of any size. Campaign works for me as the dimension. As the first of the metrics, I'll choose an average cost per click, and a second will be just clicks. Now I can see that winter offer had a very low CPC and attracted lots of clicks. Clearly we did something right there. A bubble chart shows just about the same thing, but certainly needs some visual tweaks. The next group of Looker Studio charts are pivot tables. Same as was the case for tables. There's a regular one, one with bars, and one with a heat map. Let's go with a basic option. A pivot table takes in two dimensions, one for rows and one for columns, as well as a metric to show on the chart. As a row dimension, I'll choose a platform. A column dimension should be segment. As a metric, let's look at conversions once again. A pivot table may not be as visually appealing as some previous charts I've shown you, but it gives you tons of data at a glance. And here's a pivot table with bars, and one with a heat map. If you'd like to learn more about pivot tables in Looker Studio, we've got a dedicated tutorial ready. Check it out. Next is a bullet chart. It's useful for tracking the status of a goal we're trying to accomplish. For example, let's say we want to look at our ROI, the return on investment. An average ROI makes a lot more sense here. As you could see on some earlier chart, it's slightly above $5, so I'll need to adjust the range limits. And let's say we want to keep the ROI at $4 or more. While it's not perhaps the prettiest way to demonstrate this goal, it does the job, doesn't it? Next is a treemap chart that displays all the values in a chosen dimension as rectangular branches. The larger and darker a rectangle is, the higher the value for a chosen metric. Let's change the metric to average order value. Now I can see that the Black Friday discount campaign we ran had the highest average order value. On the opposite side of the chart, I can see the worst performer. And now it's time for Sankey diagrams. They're excellent for showing flows from one set of values to another. A Sankey diagram accepts exactly two dimensions. A campaign has a bit too many values to represent on such a chart. Instead, I'll put a platform on the left and a segment on the right. As a metric, I'll get a sum of clicks. The wider a link connecting both dimensions, the higher the value for a chosen metric. So I can see, for example, that Facebook contributes the most clicks to all three segments, while the last three platforms on the left generate just about the same amount of clicks for e-commerce. The next chart on my list is a gauge chart, and it's equivalent with ranges. A gauge chart is perhaps a more visually appealing version of the bullet chart. It takes exactly one metric. I'll choose conversions here. It's often worth specifying a target as well. You can do it through the Style tab, which will add a marker on the chart describing where your goal is. And the last Looker Studio chart on the list is a waterfall chart. This chart lets you determine how a sequence of events, either positive or negative, contributes to a total value. This chart will make more sense with a platform column. As a metric, let's go once again with clicks. Now I can see who the main contributors are and who's clearly lagging behind. These were all the standard charts available in Looker Studio, but that's not all. If you're hungry for even more custom visualizations, click the icon above to use community visualizations. There's plenty to choose from. Just note that most charts are maintained by individual companies or people, and Google won't take responsibility if they suddenly stop working. Use them at your own risk. And before you go, I wanted to show you something that you may find very useful as a Looker Studio user. At Coupler.io, we prepare dashboard templates that you can connect within minutes and set up a fully fledged auto-updating dashboard with nearly no effort on your end. Track advertising campaigns, dive into web analytics, SEO, time tracking, CRMs, and more. Click on the link in the corner of your screen, find the dashboard you need, and grab it for free. And that's it. Now you know much more about Looker Studio charts. But if you have any questions, feel free to ask them down in the comments. If you enjoyed this video, please give us a like, share the video with others, and subscribe to our channel so you never miss a thing. Thank you for watching, and I will see you in the next video.